Welcome everyone. I'm thrilled to be introducing Professor Richard Plunks tonight on the occasion of his book City Riffs, Urbanism, Ecology, Place, which was just published by Lars Mueller and Columbia Books on Architecture and the City. While Richard needs no introduction, occasions such as tonight are nevertheless always a chance to trace how and how much scholars and architects such as Richard have contributed and continue to contribute to the thinking about architecture and about cities, and especially with a book such as City Riff, how interesting it is to be able to trace those contributions as an always evolving body of thinking and of work through time. In my mind, I've come to understand Richard's focus and research as quite often in advance of its time, opening up new lines of inquiry for many of us to engage with and follow. Richard's groundbreaking work on housing, which came together in his seminal A History of Housing in New York City, first published in 1990 and just republished last year, remains the unconditional reference on this topic to this day, when many of us out in the world, but also here at Columbia, are trying to re-engage with this question. Richard's deep interest in cities and in the urban scale took hold at a time when the focus on the architectural object could not have been more uncompromising. In 1992, he becomes director of GSAP's Urban Design Program, which he leads with great success for over 20 years. In 1993, he publishes Zoning and the New Horizontal City, and in 2005, he publishes The Urban Life World, Formation, Perception, Representation. That same year, Richard founds the Urban Design Lab at the Earth Institute. The lab is prolific in its research and published work, always engaging very real and complex situations, approaching them as case studies, many of which continue to be a reference until today. Richard's focus on climate change, urbanism, and ecology is first reflected through his publication, Urban Climate Change Crossroads of 2010, and then his Sustainable Food Systems for Future Cities, The Potential of Urban Agriculture of 2014. And so tonight we're celebrating what in many ways constitutes a very rich gathering of this long and complex series of research interests and threads woven together in this new publication, City Riffs, Urbanism, Ecology, Place. Moving through City Riffs, we encounter a man who engages with cities as a scholar, as an architect, and as a citizen with great investment in the places he tries to capture and understand. The essays are rich and incredibly diverse in length, tone, subject matter, and even in terms of the care he takes in projecting the different audiences they were written for. Together, these essays coalesce into a coherent depiction of Richard's approach as an architect, but also his attitude to his own work, his eye for detail, and his commitment to field work, making tangible all of the thought and consideration that goes into the development of each project. What is most striking reading through the volume is the breadth of interests. The pieces traverse the globe, visit small towns and big cities. In each essay, Richard conveys his curiosity and desire to know, but also share with us just what it is that makes a place unique. Richard closes the book by recounting a visit with a friend he has encountered over the years in Turgut Reis, and whose life has been shaped dramatically by the changes in the city over the past decade. The sensitivity to how urban planning and development impacts the lives of people makes this book very special, resonating with what Leven de Kooter once wrote: what Richard discovers in cities is their ethos, not necessarily what is quantifiable, but the dynamic of a place that must be described in words. In our age of smart cities and an uncritical faith in data, City Riffs stands as an invitation to reconsider once again what constitutes exactly what we call a city. Responding tonight, I'm also delighted to have joining us Bernard Tschumi, professor at GSAP and Dean Emeritus, Professor Kenneth Frampton, who is the Ware Professor of Architecture at Columbia GSAP, and Professor Martha Goodman, who teaches in the Art History Department at the City College of New York, and who is an alumni from our MArch program. So please join me in welcoming Professor Richard Plunks.
Okay, well, Thank you very much. That was very generous. I'm actually not used to this kind of attention, so you have to bear with me in this exercise. Yes, Amal, of course, very generously supported putting these essays together. Of course, tonight's discussion, and for me, actually, it was a very important opportunity to kind of review what I had written during this period of the Urban Design Program. And then we have this collection of people who I've interacted with in various ways over the years. I mean, Ken and I first met in 1968. It was actually October 28th. No, it was 1969 in San Francisco. And
what happened?
No, I've been putting this stuff in Avery Library. Avery Library is great, of course. I mean, Avery Library is actually my idea of a university. I've been going through all this stuff. I found this thing we did. We did a joint lecture on housing in 1977. Yes, I found it. And,
tell us about San Francisco.
Yeah. Well, San Francisco, no, that was one of those conferences. Oh. And he's been a constant colleague, here. We shared many interests, and so I really appreciated, his preface to the book, which was, I think, very insightful. And the second-year housing studio still exists, which is, I think, it's something for us. Marta was a GSAP student in the early 80s. I think, weren't you in my second-year housing studio?
No, you weren't. You didn't teach housing that year.
Okay, whatever.
I studied with Max Bond that year, and then we went to
work. Yeah, we taught together in housing studio, right?
We did teach together housing studio.
And then we did various writing and research projects before, and then she went to Berkeley, of course, to do her PhD, and now she's back at City College and the Graduate Center. But I think that article we did on 68 at Columbia, I never recovered from that with the low library administration. That was a bit of a problem. And Bernard's basically
the title, by the way, is Anatomy of Insurrections.
Bernard is basically, I think he's responsible for this in a way. I mean, he asked me in 92 to reconfigure the Urban Design Program and make it kind of a global, I don't know what we call it, but a global engagement, which I did. And so this bunch of writings really deals from that period. But I have to say also, I followed Bernard's writings on the city from, I think, the late 70s into the 80s, which are very, very interesting, still very interesting. So I sense then, and still, a kind of kindred spirit on things that are urban, in general. I should also thank James Graham. Where's James? Yeah. And Isabel and Jesse, are you all here? But, this has been a great exercise with them, because I don't know if it's totally true, but they actually seem to like the writings. they made many, many suggestions. And it was a nice exercise. And then Lars Mueller, who was unequal at what he does, was also very interesting. I mean, he made non-negotiable rules, which I sort of disagreed with, but in the end, I think they were right, including the cover. But whatever. So that's how books come together, right? And I'm trying to stay on my script in spite of the glass of wine that I just drank. And then there's Amy. Amy Schell is here. Where's Amy? Yeah, she's back there. I mean, there were... Stephen is here. Stephen. Eleni's not here. She's back in Greece. A.L. Is A.L. here? No. Well, anyway, there were these four... like assistants who really helped put this together, because it was really a mess, you know. I mean, there's all this stuff, and this is just a constant, you know, kind of consolidation or whatever. But I couldn't have done it without them. The idea for doing, putting together writings predates this book. This starts with Leven de Coter, my friend, a philosopher in Brussels, and you know, we have a long history of back and forth. And he's a little bit crazy, which I like, you know, talk about things. And he tried to get President Bush impeached, you know, the whole story about Leven. But anyway, and he puts this little thing up, this, an excerpt on the cover of the book. But I never assigned much value to any of this. You know, you just write because you got to put something down, record something. So this result, you know, and then working with James and the various people, you know, it's kind of unanticipated. I didn't know if anything would come of this or not. And I thought, well, if it doesn't, let's just forget about it. And, you know, go on to the next project. So there was a big effort just to cull through studies and try to find a pattern, which we did. You know, so this is probably 10% of what could have been used, maybe even less. I think there's some kind of pattern there. I like Leven's characterization on the back of the book, which he said it's a kind of urban time travel with words. And I like drawings, but you know, we use words. And this gets me back to, you know, a lot of the great literature, especially toward the end of the 19th century, that describes literary settings. Howells, Dreiser, you know, you have these very, very prescient descriptions in fiction that I think are very important and frequently overlooked in terms of urban documentation, understandings. So anyway, after assembling much of this thing, so I decided, yes, what we're actually doing has to do with what I call field urbanism. That is kind of field work. You know, you go somewhere and you record things and you respond to them and you react in one way or another. And I realized that a lot of this had to do with field ecology, which is a very established field, the ecological sciences, although whatever we're doing here is far more primitive. I mean, there are big textbooks on urban ecology and field urbanism, of course. But they're kind of a base, you know. So that's how the introduction developed, field urbanism, or whatever that's worth. And I should also mention, but it's very important, my association with Patricia Culligan, who's in the back, who we taught together the Urban Ecology Studio with architects and engineers for 12 years, and of course our associate and collaborators in the Urban Design Lab. So that was also an important piece of this, and that kind of kicks in halfway through this timeline. So anyway, for my idea of this discussion was we could somehow focus on the notion of writing in the city. I don't know where that's going to go. But I'm curious what our guests have to say. I did send you guys send seven questions. I don't know. Should I read the questions? Or should I read them? All right, so let's
read them.
I should read them.
No.
All right, so it's not going to take that. So, what is the role of the written word in urban analytics? Already, Ken didn't like urban analytics, so we can kick off with that one. He thought analysis was more honest and whatever. It's probably true. Is urban fiction a valuable record of urban sublime? You know, the point I just made. To what extent is the city in history still a useful concept? Because that was Mumford, for example, city in history. What is the changing nature of urban cognition? You know, and that has to do with now new social media, you know. Kind of thing that's very, very important. It's like a game changer in many ways. What about changing global ecology? Does that change everything, as Naomi Klein implies, especially for urbanism? And certainly the last 2 weeks raised that question really right in our faces. How do cities really share or not share in the new global context? And I've always thought cities have more to say to each other than, you know, the nations, but who knows? I mean, we can talk about that. And finally, and I think this is very important, and I see it in the school here, does urbanism really represent a primary or maybe the next primary force in terms of defining architectural design pedagogy and compared to, you know, a number of years ago, certainly a few years ago, I mean, there's hardly a studio, at least in the advanced studios, that doesn't have a heavily urban component of one way or another. So the other thing that's very frustrating to me is that research never gets, you know, really distilled as it would, say, in the hard sciences, you know, so we don't have the vehicle for really putting that together, but it's certainly happening. So anyway, that's, is that okay? That's good. Yes. Okay. All right. So let's see what people want.
Can we clap first?
No. I had two, but you know.
You looked up your
note.
You looked up your records. And anyway, it was an honor and a pleasure to be present at this event, and also to participate in a very limited way in writing this very short preface to this book, which testifies to Richard's long involvement in this field of urban design with enormous stamina, to say, and also...
Can you turn on the microphone?
I have to speak louder, I suppose. Yeah. All right. Yes. Embarrassing to speak louder. Anyway, Mary, of course, has always thrown me off my stroke completely, you know? I mean, it's like, you know, it's sabotage. Anyway, academic competition, never overtly stated, but always present. Yes. Fiona Friedberry said once, academic politics are the most vicious because the power is negligible. But anyway, it is an honor to be here and also to have been asked to write this preface. And rereading my preface and also rereading the book made me realize how inadequate the preface is. And also it's sort of maybe slightly somber, I think. Richard, not for a second questioned its slightly dark tone. And so that was also sufficiently satisfying. He didn't say, I can't believe it, but in any case, he accepted my few words. And of course, I begin these words with Mies van der Rohe, and that already explains my dark prejudices, in that, you know, Mies says that we can't build cities anymore. That's what he says. In 1955, he says, and we can't build old cities. It goes on like a forest, and we have to learn to live in the jungle and even do well by that. I mean, I can't believe he said this in 55. Yeah, it's just with Dougie, with Dougie. And was he wrong about this in the end? I don't really think so. I mean, I think that's the kind of... this is the world we have created now. This is the world which is... I mean, cities, there are still traditional cities, of course, there are still historic cities. But are we able to create cities? That's a very questionable issue. And could say that urban design is not about creating cities, of course. But urban design, I think, as a field, was actually invented by Jose Luis Sert and GSD in Cambridge, you know, after the Second World War. And in a way, in his sort of limited practice, he was able to sort of demonstrate his potential in a very limited way, I think, but nonetheless, rather cogent, I think. Now I think things have become very, altogether incredibly complex and difficult. And I'm reminded of the fact that José Zoltán once said, also part, same place, the birth, the cradle of urban design, what would happen to surgery if it's never practiced? I mean, this is a big question, right? And it was very aggressive of him, but was he wrong? You know, was he wrong? I'm not sure he was wrong at all. And in a way, one of the most interesting things for that I share with Richard is this, you know, this kind of these kind of landmarks of publications which are about, you know, this difficulty of urban design that crop up across time. You know, of course, the 64 Community and Privacy, Shemaev and Alexander's great book on low-rise high-density housing, with the idea that low-rise high-density housing would become a pattern of land settlement for the United States, for the Eastern Seaboard. But of course, that also fell on deaf ears, so to speak. There was never any low-rise high-density housing of consequence in the States. And 64, of course, we have Bernard Rudofsky's Architecture of Land Architects. And 67, there is this kind of bibliography we share in there. Mishan's Cost of Economic Growth, and then, of course, the 1972 Club of Rome. But what is kind of rather astonishing is that, since I obviously, or maybe not so obviously anymore, but since I went to the AA in the 50s in London and was surrounded by this climate of new towns, for example, which finally decisively end in 1972, the last British new towns in 1972, and the last Western new towns in 1972. From the point of view of creating towns, you know, the Anglo-American world stops to even imagine that it can create towns anymore. It's over. It's an uncanny thing. It's a long time ago, I think. I mean, in a way, you know, kind of unending suburbanization is embraced by the Anglo-American world and not only the Anglo-American world. So that is some of the thoughts that come to mind. I mean, it's difficult to answer these questions one after another because I think in a way, I think they're all kind of overwhelmed by the difficulty of creating any kind of urban movement that has a durability and is able to evolve and has a vision, really. I think that's probably the typical thing we face. And I think one of the issues that it raises is, you know, in what way can we really intervene in the field, you know? I like the fact that it's called field urbanism. It reminds me, of course, of Corner's field operations and I know absolutely nothing about the field ecology, but one of the problems with these scientific fields is that they are, in a certain sense, objective to the extent that they are, I think, ultimately apolitical. And so much to do with urbanism is you know, fundamentally determined by politics and vested interests. So, however scientific, you know, certain applied sciences would aspire to be, you know, they always, because of the model of science, end up with limited variables and this kind of apolitality. But you know, politics are unavoidable. This is the sobering reality, I think. You know, having read the preface, I started to reread the book all over again, you know, and it's a very touching book because it also goes back to, you know, the time of Tin Tan, and it goes back to Rensselaer, where Richard studied. It goes back to, you know, the hope of that moment, in fact. You know, that's... It's a pleasure to try to retrace that moment, but it's also painful. I think that's all I want to say.
Yeah, the parts that I like most are the early references, I have to say. You know, because it was a moment of optimism. But maybe that has to do with being a student or almost a student, you know, kind of. You gotta believe, you know, you believe in something, you know, you all do that already, well, even now, but at that moment there was a notion that one could actually adjust things in the world. And I don't think the issues were so different, actually. I mean, certainly the Club of Rome put everything on the table and can't deny that, right? And then there were the practices that, you know, that we understood as being very important. But that passes. But the interesting thing that I found is kind of going through this stuff, which looking at it really, that, you know, I wrote, but now I'm like an outsider to it, is there is a kind of consistency. And Ali Karakas, yes, that almost closes the circle. I mean, that is somebody that we met. This was a very early Columbia Global Studios in Turkey, in Turkey Trees, 1974 summer. And we met these families, and we worked with them, et cetera, and we went back 5 or 6 times. David Smiley was one of the 86. Mabel Wilson, 1990, you know. And that evolved into a real indictment. And I guess it's not such a... I debated, well, should I even put it in there, or should I put it in another book, but okay, that's it, you know, it's a commentary that I thought was kind of useful, but, Martin, you're in between, you know, so, and then Bernard was responsible for this.
So, I have to use mic. I apologize, I'm suffering from a very bad cold, so if I break into paroxysms of coughing, it's the biology. Anyway, it's a pleasure to be here. I haven't be back to be here to be part of a conversation with the architecture school. It's been a while. And it is a privilege to be sitting here with the two people who shaped my formation as a new architecture student. I'm speaking here for Richard and Ken. There are others in the audience who did the same as well, Mary Cloud. I was a student here at an extraordinary moment in New York, an extraordinary moment in the school's history, And I think that some of that may have slipped from view, but it's, for me, the sadness and the interest that comes from reading the book is to read a story about a set of investigations that happened at Columbia long after I had gone. And I decided on another professional course for myself, which is to become a historian. And so, for me, this is as much a reportage of a history of the school as it is of a reflection on a school's practice, as it is about Richard's work in and of itself, and Richard's work across the world. When I taught at, went to school at Columbia and taught here, the world, we didn't see the world in the way that, or treat the world in the way that it's discussed in this book. You were among one of the first people to do so, to start to think about our role, our place in a global society. Those words weren't even on the table, those phrases, but, and the Turkish project was one of them. I remember hearing about that in your office, and I was very happy and very pleased to, saddened to read the outcome of the story of your engagement with this family who I knew meant so much to you. I never worked on the Turkish project. And yet I also, in looking at the book, it also astonished me that so much of what grabbed our attention at Columbia at that point in the architecture school, which was the city of New York, isn't present in the book. Present in the book in the way that it was when I was a student and worked here and taught here, and that offered a moment of reflection for me about the ways in which the local and the global are connected, and the ways in which trajectories and questions changed schools over the course of the years. It was, I would say, deeply reassuring to learn about a new point of connection, and that point of connection being the work of the sociologist and political philosopher Henri Lefebvre, who is a thinker who I came into contact with my work at Berkeley, particularly through the work of the studies I did with the geographer Alan Pred, and also with the historian Del Upton, also who was my advisor at Berkeley. And for me, Lefebvre was a person, reading Lefebvre and thinking of Lefebvre and thinking of Lefebvre's insights about architecture, the production of space, the role of cities, exploded my way of thinking. It transformed me and went on to change the way in which I approach the study, my work as a historian and my work as a teacher, and I now bring Lefebvre into all of the teaching I do in city, and it's a very, very productive way of engaging architecture students with questions of the social, the physical, and the discursive as we like to meditate on in both history sections and in discussion sections and in seminars. And so the thread of Lefebvre in this text, right, the thread of Lefebvre, Lefebvre hadn't been translated into English when I studied and taught at Columbia. I think probably the only person on this panel had read Lefebvre was Bernard, because Bernard is fluent in French, of course. And yet we find that the translation, which happened in 91, and which really changed American thought, I believe, did so in Columbia, right, as well as Berkeley, right? And that becomes a theme, a moment of a theme we can invoke as a kind of shared practice intellectually. And I think perhaps a way of thinking about a moment of hope in countering Kent's, I think, well-placed somber mood, one that I share rather directly with regard to the political situation. But I think with Lefebvre, what we find is we find a way of thinking about cities that lets us imagine or lets us understand the vitality of everyday life, the aspirations for change, the ways in which we as designers and thinkers and writers and drawers might imagine different futures which are rooted in urban places. That's what I have to say. I would just at that for my students at City College and my students at the Graduate Center. LaFave is liberating. LaFave offers them a way to imagine a space for intervention.
Three, you get me?
Good. All right.
There's something rather nice tonight about, and thanks a lot for rediscovering this place, which is a library, and talk about the city. I didn't decide to be an architect right away. I was born in a charming city filled with trees and nature, and went everywhere with a bicycle, and frankly I hated it. Tried to escape, and at age 17 found myself in Chicago for a week and was absolutely fascinated. The density of the place, it was not the Chicago of today, it was the Chicago of the early 60s, when the Loop still existed, when those buildings, that actually that mass of building in the center of the city, with all the buildings the same height, 12 stories, but the streets were no larger than 25 feet. The power of it was 10 times greater than the power of New York City. And there, that fascination was for me. was really what made me want to become an architect. It was a city, and a city of a certain type of, use the word, density, and a very hard, harsh, powerful mass of buildings, which didn't let much daylight come in, which had zero trees and zero bicycle, except then a noisy, you know, overhead sort of tram. So the reason why I start with this is that we are today in a world where pedestrianization, bicyclization, that's a French word, actually, has replaced, and they wish to make everything green, has replaced a, what I would describe as a major city culture. In other words, rather than looking at the world that has made us, right, and here, because we are in a library, I can't resist to quote, by the way, I liked your word, Richard, when you talked about urban fiction. And urban fiction is also, it's not only about stories, but it has about something about race, about African-American writers, and it has to do with profanity and with sex, with violence. Things which ultimately were not that different from what Charles Dickens would write, or Victor Hugo, or James Joyce. In other words, it is about the city as a form of intelligence. And I can bring some other words that I just wrote before coming here. George Orwell, Italo Calvino. Hey, this afternoon, asking my students, have you read Invisible Cities? What? Question mark, no idea, never heard of. Raymond Chandler, William Gibson, Zadie Smith, Mac Davis, Paul Auster, and so on. In other words, something which seems today to be disappearing. For me, arriving in New York, well, the second or third time around, you know, after Chicago, I came to New York and was quite fascinated too, but that was something else. But later, arriving here for good in the mid 60s, 42nd Street, however filled with, quote again, profanity, self, and violence, was a particular type of urban city culture. And this one seems to be under threat. I see it in Paris, I see it in New York, I see it, you know, today, if you see what is happening with, you know the place. So in other words, there is something which is happening that is one at a time when whatever this, the percentages are given, that 75% of the world will be urbanized in 2050. Wait, a city is something very specific. It's not a place which tries to emulate the countryside. It's something which is loaded with, I could go into, for my love for the cinema, right? Metropolis, M, Lady from Shanghai, Public Enemy, Scarface, Citizen Kane, Naked City, Monty's Falcon, Asphalt Jungle, Blade Runner, Chinatown, etc. You know this. That's the point, that it's a certain way to live and to develop our culture. And so the reason why I bring this a little bit as a manifesto is that when I took Richard's book and I started to flick through it, I was enormously happy to see a form of representation that has been now banned or forgotten called the how do you call that? The figure ground, right? In other words, a way to deal with city as the congestion of a number of minds that simply develop a number of scenarios together to live in a way which would not be possible otherwise. And I wish that this, I was happy to hear you, Marta, bringing Lefebvre. I invited Lefebvre in 1972 to speak at the ICA in London, and I was foolish enough to think that I could translate him in English, and I really had our time. But what I, when you mentioned that, it reminded me that Thames and Hudson then asked me to write a review of the production of Space, so that they would know whether they would publish it, translate it and publish it in English or not. And I must have made a very bad job if they indeed waited till 91 to, you know. Thank you.
There were snippets of Lefebvre.
The early books from the 60s, and we all read Espace Societe. It was known, Marta, before 90. Well,
might have been.
I think it was forgotten.
Yeah, I think.
But anyway, I mean, this is very interesting.
We didn't read them.
Because Bernard actually can raise the issue of has the city just moved beyond our comprehension? I mean, as a city in history, you know, as Mumford defined it, based on the definitive book, of course, when we were students, certainly, is that, have we simply moved beyond that, or are we in some kind of pathology? Of course, you get arguments on all sides of this issue, but I think it's actually a crucial question, and I think it does engage ecology at this point. I mean, can a construct like Houston or Miami exist, and to what degree is, I mean, now, given the, you know, the kind of global constraints that we face, or is it simply a misconceived construct and somehow has strayed so far from like the conceptual city as a human concept, you know, as a human construct that it's that is beyond repair. And I somehow my biases, of course, yeah, were over the edge. But then you hear the counter argument, well, you don't know what you're talking about, you know, dispersal is the way it's going to go, and, you know, this and that, and this and that. But I think the if there was a pattern in the book, you know, which sort of looked for patterns with various people involved, I mean, probably that's the biggest question. I mean, it raises the issue of what is a city and how far are we now from what is actually a viable concept for the city compared to the historical city, or are we simply beyond history? History doesn't count, end of history, that sort of thing. You know, the thing about literature was also very interesting to me because putting this together forced me to think more about literary descriptions and I wasn't born in New York City, but certainly my family had a long history here. I was involved with upstate cities, which were still cities. I mean, now they're really wastelands, you know, places like Troy. And very interesting to me are actually the literary descriptions of those places. W.D. Howells wrote a little thing called the Albany Depot. Albany had two very large train stations. Now one is a shopping mall, and I don't know what the other one is. But it is still there. Schenectady had a very urbane station, New York Central Railroad, with a commercial kind of arcade and, you know, integrated in the city. And then you go to an author like, you know, I've thought about this, Dreiser, for example, in American Tragedy, he describes that city and the main street, State Street, and how the major protagonist who's looking for a drugstore where he can find a way to have an abortion for his girlfriend. You know the story probably. But anyway, you know, he's wandering around these streets, and the discussion of the city as structure, spatial structure, is so powerful. Or the Albany Depot, or the train station in Troy where Vonnegut went through all the time. I mean, you know, he got all his crazy ideas probably from going in the, you know, this kind of environment. So it's also not just large cities. So I thought a lot about what Bernard is saying about, you know, these were hard places and very different than now. Now they're basically destroyed or dispersed beyond recognition. One other little thing, because we're all friends, right, or whatever. So when I was 10 years old, I didn't have a bicycle, but my mother, who could go from her town to Grand Central Station in 3 hours, which was just north of Troy, which you can't even do anymore. And if you try to go from Albany, it's like, God help us, you know, you don't know where you're going to end up or how long it's going to take on Amtrak. But so she said, she put us together and said, now we're going to take the train because these things aren't going to exist anymore. So we went from Schenectady to Albany to Troy. I saw all that infrastructure, all those stations, and she was right. You know, it didn't take long to go away. And now you wonder, well, will this be reinvented, or are we beyond reinvention somehow? So these are, you know, we all have these stories, right? Because you span generations of urban, and there are generations, of course, so. Anyway, that was gratuitous. But I also thought about my mother, because, you know, that was an important lesson. I didn't know it at the time. So what, you know, why is she doing this to us? Mary, what do you say?
I was actually thinking almost of the opposite. I grew up in a suburb without urbanity. Of course, I was dying to leave it. But my father's dream was when the subway in Washington, D.C. would finally get to the Maryland suburbs. And of course, it happened after I left Maryland suburbs. But there is this strange way where the suburbs have often become more urban than they were. It's complete ethnic mixture where I grew up, and it was lily white when I was young. There's a huge Korean market up the hill from which was just, you know, suburban nothing. And so there are these strange inversions, some of which, you know, we can be negative about, but are also more positive. The suburb is certainly not as provincial, as constricted as it was when I was growing up. I miss that toughness. I mean, I think anyone who lived in New York in the 70s, it was both horrific but exciting, and you could afford it. You could also have space. So these what's gained, what's lost, I think is a constant question. Strangely, I feel like I never knew enough about the Urban Design Program. And that's one of the things I always wondered about Columbia, that as much as I knew Richard, and we taught together in the housing studio, I never knew there were ways in which there were silos within the school, despite shared interests. And I wonder to what extent that continues, to what extent it might be challenged. End of thoughts.
I have just some things to add to it. One is that I think both for architecture and for urban design and for related fields, you know, the question is strategies of intervention, I think, is a big issue. Richard knows as well as I do this late Catalan urbanist Manuel de Sala Morales, who came up with the idea of urban acupuncture as a way of characterizing this and a strategy of intervention. And this large block that is built in the Avenida de Diagonal in Barcelona is a kind of exemplar of that, as a, with Manet as architect, but de Sala Morales as an urbanist. So I think this question of I think it also applies to architecture. I mean, when you think of, you know, well, in what ways can architecture still intervene significantly in a society like this? It's quite not so easy to answer that question, I think. And by society like this, I mean, of course, you know, this capitalism, consumerism that is just running away with itself. And the way in which provincial cities, for example, and that's true in England, have been, you know, completely blown apart by, you know, suburban supermarkets. I mean, the shopping streets have just been destroyed by the same principle as happened in the United States. That's just a fact of late 20th and early 21st century, you know, urban economy, consumer economy altogether. And it's not so easy but I think it's somehow necessary to find kind of strategies of intervening, because that's the most probably these kinds of professions can really do, you know, in terms of any kind of active creation. So it makes me think of that, you know, because the provincial city that Richard is talking about has been, and I think that provincial city has a kind of city-state idea, particularly strong in Europe, but also present elsewhere, both politically and culturally. It's particularly true in Spain, has been a really important client. Without that decentralized client, it's hard to know on what ground, where's the ground on which one can develop a discourse about it. And one last point, you know, I think that you know, what is happening to Manhattan, and also Chicago, and to, you know, this never-ending, unstoppable obsession with one high-rise building, is in fact, you know, destroying the fabric right before our very eyes, you know, destroying it socially, and economically, and driving people out of the city. In fact, students, you know, middle class, the whole lot, are being driven out by the enormous explosion of economic wealth in the center of the city. So, it's obviously happening.
Thank you.
I have a question I'd like to pose in relationship to the writing question, but before I do that, I wanted to say that the sort of the themes of doom and of over the historian in me says this is not the first time we've raised these questions, right? And so we can imagine New York in the beginning of the 20th century and the ways in which we hear stories of overbuilding and congestion and unwanted peoples and a city that can't be grasped or understood because it's so new and so different, and how this feeds a kind of sense of despondence about the future. And we know what happened, right, which is that certainly in the case of this city, people figured out how to get together and imagine a role for government that was productive. And so I do think we need to meditate, need to think a bit about, I mean, listen, I hate scroll as much as you do. I don't find it life-giving. But there are people who do, and somehow those different perspectives, I think, need to be taken into account into figuring out how we go forward. I think one thing that will happen is that at some point the cost of all of this stuff is going to come home to roost, and that is that the expansion of the American city and the way that we've seen the development of these high rises and whatever are all based on energy regimes that don't work, right? I mean, no one really pays for what the public pays for the cost of running buildings, buildings of this scale, of replacing transportation systems that worked at one point and are wantonly destroyed, and for a consumer society that doesn't in any way, in its pricing, account for the ways in which the true costs that are involved in the making of the stuff we make, and I include buildings in that. I don't see how we can sustain this kind of economy in relationship to the environmental devastation that it causes, and the storms of the last 3 months, last 3 weeks, being short indicators of why we can't. So that would be one set of criteria for me, that there's a political and an economical, a political economy that we must address, and you both taught me this, right? I mean, for goodness sakes. you did. That we can't, that architecture can't do everything, that we have to engage politics, we have to think economically as well as in other ways. Those are tall orders, but I think, again, looking for a moment of hope, right, in a season in which there's every reason to find despair, or certainly somber moods, we can find previous moments of despair and despair about the future, and look at the ways in which Americans and others organized to create different futures. And I do think that's incumbent upon us as teachers and as practitioners, for those of you who are, and also as writers. I would also say that just thinking broadly about the economy is that the continued crises of capitalism are ones that in which the economy devours the people who it needs to consume its products, and at a certain moment that crisis will also have to be addressed. Certainly a component in a recent election in this country. But for a moment, I wanted to talk about something, to raise another question, which is to come back, Richard, to your question about writing the city. And we've heard writing the city, filming the city. And I also wanted to say that, yes, I do. I mean, this is what I chose to do, is to write rather than to draw. And what I would argue that there's an enormous power in imagining urban futures through writing, through creating manifestos, through raising questions, through the kinds of discussions we have right here, for sure. But what I also wonder, and it's really prompted by the stories and the drawings in this book, right? You know, the settings that you've encountered in all of these different places all over the world. Gosh, I was jealous of all those trips. To get to go see all these places, to meet all these people, to think about this, but still, it's pretty impressive. And to think about Columbia investing in that kind of quest is really astonishing. But I wonder, how do we draw the social? I know I can write the social. I do it all the time, but how do we draw it? How do we make the social come alive through our drawings, which for me is a central, central question.
Let me try. You mentioned, you know, the climate, you mentioned the economy, you mentioned the price of gasoline, and of course the social. All that is really fundamental. It's part of our life as a citizen. We have to understand it. And as architects, or call it planners, physical planners, or the word, or urban designers, we have to take it into consideration. It's part of the job. If you don't do that, you're not doing your job well. But the point that I want to make, and I get back to the issue of urban culture, your city culture, you also have to know your basics. There's a whole history of cities, as your book called From Babylon to Brasilia. And since then, there have been a few other things. In other words, there are ways to understand all the different mechanisms that make a city. Today, when a state, a city, or a large corporation decides to build for 2,600 people, I'm just working on a project like this, or for 30,000 people, or 300,000 people, they don't ask architects. They don't ask urban designers. They do it all themselves, with a few transport, you know. So it means that somewhere we have disappeared from the map on something which is absolutely fundamental, where there is a specific knowledge which we are the only one who have it. And so I'm just a little, you know, I'm all in favor of architects, but I get irritated when all campuses in, you know, not Colombia, but in this in the country, want to ask landscape architects rather than architects to expand, redevelop, improve, adjust their campus. So there is something which is going away, and when it goes away, it may not come back. And so you don't be surprised, Amal, when I say what I said the other day, you know, you have to educate the client. Because at the moment, I think that ignorance is something that's, you know, when one makes the, one used to make the difference between the American city and the European city. Today, there's such a homogenization, and it's not because of Prada, Gucci, Starbucks, and Victoria's Secrets that they all share. It's simply that the city is considered, the dense city, as a place of tourism, a place of show, and not any more than, I get to your point, of the social. But again, the social is only a manifestation. It has to also to take into consideration the craft, and that's why I think, Richard, you were doing a good job in trying to discuss a little bit what those causes that don't exist anymore, you know, the history of urbanism, nobody does. And the issue is very real, because if nobody does it but us, then you're not going to get to anything else but the standard reason why cities in South Korea look the same as the one in, say, in Dubai or in Yemen. And this effect of complete ignorance is really something that we in the academic world start to worry about, or should.
I absolutely agree. I think there's a danger of suffering and amnesia in our field. You know, I mean, I work with a, I don't know if Patricia's still here, but you know, it's been a very interesting experience to work with the engineers and then and some of the science folks in the Earth Institute, and you know, they're kind of a pain. You know, they do all these peer-reviewed articles and stuff, and you know, all that stuff that goes on. But on the other hand, there is a culture and a mechanism for evolution, right? And I do have a feeling that we have some kind of break now that we have to be quite careful about. You know, it may be quite temporary or not, and there's so many external factors involved in how we build, how we make cities. I think we're at the end of the moment. I mean, we're not going to have the optimism about the form of the city and dispersal that existed in the 50s. I mean, that's so far gone. But on the writing issue, I think Bernard did combine spatial and social and verbal, you know, in that work that we were so, you know, so interested in. A while back, but you know, the question is who's doing it now and what form it's taking, and it's happening, but I don't know if it's coming so much from architecture.
Yeah, but I'll sort of add a footnote. Again, as an architect now, not as an educator, I'm often asked to, you know, to compete or to propose or to design buildings within a master plan. And they are all the same. They are sort of watered down beyond clear. as if this way was the way you did a master plan. There are 10 ways, 20 different ways to do master plans. Everybody has forgotten that it's possible, right? They're determined by the width of fire trucks and whatever, and there's absolutely no thinking. And that's my issue about saying that there is a culture which then is not transmitted or which has been abolished or which has been censored. But I think there is a serious issue there. Due to this homogeneity, and again when I say Dubai, Mumbai, we used to say Shanghai, it's, you know, it's a...
Richard talks about patterns of nesting, in fact. I think at the end has these sort of topological states of different kinds of settlement patterns. I was thinking during the course of this that there are, despite Margaret Thatcher, there are some alternatives, and in a way, I think we don't really completely understand what alternatives exist. I was thinking during this conversation of the city of Lyon, which I recently visited, and which I was astonished by the way it has been developed in the last 10, 15 years, where clearly, you know, the local administration has decided to develop a system. It is all one height, as far as I can see. And it is all blocks and in rush. It's an old kind of, you know, Hippodamian gritty city. But this is the model they've used, and I think it's been extraordinarily successful. But, you know, it's another one of those things that I've never seen a book on it, I know nothing about it. I mean, I just know this passing experience. But I think there are models like that we know of, but we don't know. For example, I think the other thing that comes to mind is Curitiba, which everyone knows about, but there's no decent book on Curitiba. You know, it's like something out there that existed and still exists and is still developing, presumably, using, in a very intelligent way, bus transportation and designated lanes. But, you know, it's like we don't have, that's the least paradoxical thing. That, you know, universities are places of research, but in some funny way, particularly in this field, I think there are different kind of bits and pieces here and there, which somehow remain almost mythic, you know, in terms of what we know about this.
we don't have the discipline of the hard sciences for good reason, but yes, I have the same frustration. We can't do it the way they do it, but we don't have a mechanism of learning, you know, accumulating learning. But are we supposed to have some questions? Or what do we do?
That'd be good, yes.
Yes. Word is getting out. Philippe. How are you? Philippe, when I taught in Leuven in Belgium, Philippe, I think, were you in the class when I taught?
I was running around.
Or you, yeah, we were kind of, and that reminds me how important exposure is. I mean, you really have to understand urbanism, you have to understand places and conditions. And actually, Belgium was very interesting for me, and of course, it's changed a lot since then. Philippe Decourt is the head of Human Habitat at UN in New York, doing interesting work on immigration and sort of thing. But anyway, that was a big introduction to the Flemish town for me, right? I mean, that was different than our densities, different fabrics, but a place that felt very comfortable. It's totally changed. There were still horse meat restaurants there, things like that. There's still plenty of beer and that sort of thing, which was nice. But you know, I mean, are we just talking about the frustrations of Western urbanization? Because you're very involved with, you know, Global South and, you know, what do we? Do you have a perspective? I mean, you're sitting in the front, so.
No, but I mean, for me, it's extremely fascinating because we're in the UN, which is a small corner of New York. In the last couple of years, I think largely also to our executive director, the ex-mayor of Barcelona, he made a big push for cities suddenly to be considered by nations, by national governments within the UN discussions. And we have a sustainable development goal, which sounds very lofty, but there's this very specific target on public space, which we never imagined would appear in a multilateral commitment of national governments. And I think we underestimate the potential of that being there. And from there, we kind of try to spin around with them, rethinking cities. And for me, I mean, and my colleague Andrew sitting behind me, we're like, how do we bring the work you have been doing and now use that window of opportunity to bring it back? Because I think people understand, and the US is a very good example, but so is some of the other places, Nairobi in the world, is, and it's universal, the issue of inequity and exclusion and segregation. It's hitting governments big time. And they're starting to look around, what do we do? And so for me, going back to all the work has been all the thinking, there is an opportunity. But it does mean connecting back now this global discussion with the work. Like you said, the science almost of cities.
That's what I meant by drawing.
Yeah. I don't know how to do it, but for me it's the thing to do. So no questions.
Michael, what about Michael? You're doing even your studio in California with large new neighborhood. How are you doing with these issues?
Thank you for asking.
Sorry.
No, I have a response. So, first of all, I know the work too well, so it's in some sense that I'm here hearing your own reaction to the work and the question about the social, for example. I instantly thought of Manhattan Transcripts and that kind of that work as well, and scenarios like that. But I have a slightly different reaction. Maybe I missed the first 10 minutes. I had to leave. I was at Stanford for the large part of the year, not teaching, but I was a visiting professor running a colloquium. They ran a survey in the engineering school through 5 years, led by the dean who became the provost. What are the big questions for engineering? And they don't have an urban design school at Stanford, nor do they really have architecture, a little minor. Anyway, the question that rose to the top of the list with a huge faculty was, how do they know if the future city is humane? And they felt kind of at a loss to mobilize all of this talent because they don't perceive that they have the synthetic ability that you would get in something like urban design, as opposed to urban planning or architecture. So, but there's, you know, it's not, forget about Stanford for a moment, but just all of these kind of, I think a huge issue underneath that is, you know, the engines of urbanization, the automobile, the battery, the car, the solar panel, everything that sort of drove the last version of, you know, post-war sprawl. So much of that is being, you know, re-monetized, not, and some of it's being reinvented. So I would argue that we're, I think a lot of people sense a kind of anxiety, I think in all senses, of there's what was lost, but indeed what is coming, and how do we even understand the shape of that? I get in the lottery, I was talking about economics, but I was pointing at things like American residential real estate is worth about $27 trillion right now. You can find that in the Federal Reserve flow of funds pretty easily. It went down by something like $8 trillion in the crash. It went from 25 to 18, now it's back up to 29. It's like wild fluctuations based on precarious financial situations or just the amount of debt and leverage that is underneath government right now, that's underneath private households right now, and that has accelerated wildly over 70 years. So like questions about the future of leverage as the device that enabled the single family house, that enabled the $40,000 car in a $60,000 house. And I would just argue that we're, you know, Uber and all of that is just the tip of the iceberg of playing around with old assets that are about to really be reinvented. So I think urban design is so utterly interesting that way because it's caught between being urban planning and being architecture, at least, forgive me if that's not the way you see it. But, so yeah, I'm not so worried about losing Albany or losing Schenectady or Troy, even though I absolutely get that concern. So much as kind of thinking about how do you mobilize the school to really be ready for that. And it does require amateur economics on our part, and not the kind of ethical side of economics of inequity, which is real, of course, is not really pivotal, but it's even just getting a grasp on it to know what's at play. The number that I was talking about in the lottery was, we build 1 million units of housing a year in this country generally. We built 25% of this country's housing in the last 30 years. So what are we building in the next 30? In other words, the change, despite it seeming like it's all homogeneous, it in fact is a huge amount new, but we're not on the scene for that. So I don't mean to be positive or negative so much as to say that.
But 90% of the production doesn't have an architect here.
No, it's like $8 a house for architectural fees in this country, literally 0.0028%. But I think the question that's there is, it's like shocking to think that we built 25% of this country's housing in 30 years. So if we think what we want to be part of going forward, how on earth do we, and then think that we're really changing so much of the tools that built it. You know, the banks are all pulling out of private mortgages. They don't want to be part of it anymore. A lot of people think the mortgage industry will move to being more of a utility. In other words, you don't go have a little personal conversation to get a mortgage. It'll increasingly be something that's borne by a central government as a form of utility. But in other words, like new economics causes new design. So, but I think urban design and the work you've done, every time I've been around it, it's utterly amazing. And I always tease Richard that you ran the housing studio before you did urban design, right? You and Ken.
Yeah, we.
Then you guys got kind of moved together from doing housing on a couple of blocks to talking about.
Right. Which, you know, it is, I mean, there's a source of continuity in education that I think, you know, it's changed and transformed, but I think it's very important. But actually, I'm very optimistic for Troy, Albany, Schenectady.
I think
there's social and infrastructural investment there that can be reinvented. Orlando, I don't know, Phoenix, I don't know, but yeah, I think there was a logic to those settlement patterns, which one can probably still resurrect and,
yeah,
and manage. I mean, all of New York State was really a megapolitan corridor, you know, New York to Buffalo, which was really an urban construct. My mind is waiting to be reinvented. But there's a whole rest of the world. And you know, I really wonder about China, which I know something about, but not so much about. And the commodification of housing related to, industrial markets like cars. And, you know, you wonder, in the big picture, where all of this is going. But, you know, we were talking about it before with the person from Hong Kong. I'm very optimistic for New York. We're in a very good spot, but there's the discrepancies between social class and income, of course, that are more and more extreme here. But New York will survive as an entity. And it has to be protected. I had a lot of, over the years, interesting discussions with Levin Decoder, who's, you know, is very interesting guy in Brussels, a philosopher, but teaches architects and other members. And maybe there's a little discussion in the book with him. But I argued that, listen, I am willing to pay more to go and buy a quart of milk in Manhattan than to go to Costco somewhere in the suburbs, because I value what that means, right? And the extent to which that kind of market will evolve and grow, I think, is very important for urbanism. I mean, we're all in the same boat. And there's a cost, but there's huge benefits socially. But I don't know how many people can be convinced. The turning point in the U.S. was the mid-90s when the suburban majority took, in the census, became a majority, and then we had George Bush and all this kind of thing. But, you know, that's probably also shifting, because these things are so political. I'm not so sure that what that majority represented back 20 years ago is going to be the same, you know, 10 years from now. I think it's changing. What can we stop? Is there still wine or anything?
Yes.
So why don't we just...
I promised Richard that the book wasn't a closure, but it was a beginning, and I think this kind of conversation is really inviting us to build on the many, you know, examples that you gave. And so please continue to join us for, you know, drinks and cheese and wine and discussion. Thank you, Richard. Thank you, everyone.